And you know, we begin early to ask life to put us first. Our first cry as a baby was a bid for attention. And all through childhood, the drum major impulse or instinct is a major obsession. Children ask life to grant them first place. They are a little bundle of ego. They have innately the drum major instinct. Now in adult life we still have it, and we really never get by it. We like to do something good, and you know, we like to be praised for it. And if you don't believe that, you just go on living life and you will discover very soon that you like to be praised. Everybody likes it, as a matter of fact. And somehow this warm glow we feel when we are praised or when our name is in print is something of the vitamin A to our ego. Nobody is unhappy when they are praised, even if they know they don't deserve it, and even if they don't believe it. The only unhappy people about praise is when that praise is going too much towards somebody else. But everybody likes to be praised because of this real drum major instinct. Do you know that a lot of the race problem grows out of the drum major instinct? That some people have to feel superior. A need that some people have to feel that they are first, and to feel that their white skin ordained them to be first. They have said over and over again, in ways that we see with our own eyes. In fact, not too long ago, a man down in Mississippi said that God was a charter member of the White Citizens Council. And so, God being the charter member means that everybody who's in that has a kind of divinity, a kind of superiority. Think of what has happened in history as a result. This perverted use of the drum major instinct led to the most tragic prejudice, the most tragic expressions of man's inhumanity to man. And not only does this thing go into the racial struggle, it goes into the struggle between nations. I would submit to you this morning that what is wrong in the world today is that the nations of the world are engaged in a bitter, colossal contest for supremacy. And if some doesn't happen to stop this trend, I'm sorely afraid that we won't be here to talk about Jesus Christ and about God and about brotherhood too many more years. If somebody doesn't bring an end to this suicidal thrust that we see in the world today, none of us are going to be around, because somebody's going to make the mistake through our senseless blunderings of dropping a nuclear bomb somewhere, and then another one is going to drop. And don't let anybody fool you. This can happen within a matter of seconds. They have 20 megaton bombs in Russia right now that can destroy a city as big as New York in 3 seconds, with everybody wiped away in every building. And we can do the same thing to Russia and China. But this is why we are drifted, and we are drifting there, because nations are caught up with the drum major instinct. I must be first. I must be supreme. Our nation must rule the world. I am sad to say that the nation in which we live is the supreme culprit. I'm going to continue to say it to America, because I love this country too much.
perplexed to see the drift that it has taken. God didn't call America to do what she's doing in the world now. God didn't call America to engage in a senseless, unjust war as the war in Vietnam. And we are criminals in that war. We have committed more war crimes almost than any nation in the world. And I'm going to continue to say it. We won't stop it because of our pride and our arrogance as a nation. But God has a way of even putting nations in their place. God that I worship has a way of saying, don't play with me. Has a way of saying, as the God of the Old Testament used to say, Hebrews, don't play with me. Don't play with me, Babylon. Every now and then I go back and read Gibbon's Decline and Fall of the Roman Empire. When I come and look at America, I see to myself the parallels are frightening. We have perverted the drum major instinct. Let me rush on to my conclusion because I want you to see what Jesus was really saying. What was the answer that Jesus gave these men? It's very interesting. One would have thought that Jesus would have condemned them. One would have thought that Jesus would have said, you are out of your place. You are selfish. Why would you raise such a question? That is what Jesus did. He did something altogether different. He said in substance, oh, I see. You want to be first? You want to be great? You want to be important? You want to be significant? Well, you ought to be. If you're going to be my disciple, you must be. He reordered priorities. And he said, yes, don't give up this instinct. It's a good instinct if you use it right. It's a good instinct if you don't distort it and pervert it. Don't give it up. Keep feeling the need for being important. Keep feeling the need for being first. And I want you to be first in love. I want you to be first in moral excellence. I want you to be first in generosity. That is what I want you to do. He transformed the situation by giving a new definition of greatness. And you know how he said it? He said, now, brethren, I can't give you greatness. And really, I can't make you first. This is what Jesus said to James. Earn it. True greatness comes not by favoritism but by fitness. The right hand and the left are not mine to give. They belong to those who are prepared. So Jesus gave us a new norm of greatness. If you want to be important, recognize, wonderful. If you want to be great, wonderful. But recognize that he who is greatest among you should be yourself. That's a new definition of greatness. This morning, the thing that I like about it, by giving that definition of greatness, it means that everybody can be great. Because everybody can realistically about that day when we will be victimized of what is life's final common denominator. That's something we call death.
about it, and every now and then I think about my own death, and I think about my own funeral, and I don't think of it in a morbid sense. Every now and then I ask myself, what is it I would want said? And I leave the word to you this morning. If any of you around when I have to meet my day, I don't want a long funeral. And if you get somebody to deliver the eulogy, tell them not to talk to me. Every now and then I wonder what I want them to say. Tell them not to mention that I have a Nobel Peace Prize. That is it. Tell them not to mention that I have 300 or 400 other awards. That's not important. Tell them not to mention where I went to school. I'd like somebody to mention that day that Martin Luther King Jr. tried to give his life serving others. I'd like for somebody to say that day that Martin Luther King Jr. tried to love somebody. I want you to say that day that I tried to be